Hey church fam, we're so excited that you're joining us today. My name is Fabian Macias and I serve on the worship team.
I'm Damaris, I serve on the bookstore. Undoubtedly, we know God is doing great things here at Harvest and we would love for you to share this with a friend. You can share the link hcclpaso.com/live to a friend in need.
And as a church, we want to be praying for you and your needs. Submit your prayer request to hcclpaso.com/prayer.
Grab a coffee.
Grab a friend.
And let's get our praise on.
Morning, church. I want to invite you all to stand and join us.
When all was lost, you saved us.
sing this.
I'm fighting back with a song of praise. I'm fighting back, lifting up your name. My quiet voice can make mountains shake. Jesus, turn my fear to flee. And when there's death, Jesus, you are life. When I'm alone, you are by my side. I look to you in the darkest night. You have shown me how to fight. When I'm afraid, I will lift you up. Jesus, my hope, you're the one I love. I'll shout your name and I'll never stop. Let my praise be on this battleground.
Now's the time. Here we go.
Now is the time. Voices join as one. In scattered rooms, let your kingdom come. Your holy church sings in the sun. This praise is our weapon. 'Cause when I'm afraid, when I'm afraid, Jesus, my hope, you're the one I love. I'll shout your name and I'll never stop. Let my praise be.
Let's sing it again.
This battleground, Jesus. If I'm afraid, I will lift you up. Jesus, my hope, you're the one I love. I'll shout your name. Praise be on this battleground, Jesus.
We praise you this morning, hallelujah. Let's sing this. We do not grieve.
Do not grieve like those without hope. Death's not the end, it's you calling us home. And there's no power you can overcome. You took our death and then Jesus, you
won. Sing it again.
We do not grieve like those without hope. Death's not the end, calling the soul. And there's no power you can overcome. You took on death and then Jesus you won. Oh,
you're the champion of the world. Oh Lord, we thank you, Lord. We lift up your praises this morning. Let's sing this chorus.
When I'm afraid, I will lift you up. Jesus, my hope, you're the one I love. I'll shout your name and I'll never stop. Let my praise be on this battleground.
Sing it again.
Jesus, when I'm afraid, I will lift you up. Jesus, my hope, you're the one I love. I'll shout your name and I'll never stop. Let my praise be on this battleground, Jesus.
You're the champion of the world. We lift up our praise to you this morning, Lord, because you already overcame. Let's sing this. We do not grieve.
We do not grieve like those without hope. That's not the end. It's you calling a soul. And there's no power you can't overcome. You took on death and then Jesus you won. And we do not grieve like those without hope. That's not the end, it's calling a soul. And there's no power you can't overcome. You took on death and then Jesus you won. Of the war, your name will prevail.
Tells us that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. So let's take a moment and just hail King Jesus together. Let's declare that he is Lord. Let's confess with our mouths that he is Lord. Let's sing that again as one body today.
And all hail King Jesus. all hail the Savior.
Come on, keep singing, keep singing.
All hail,
we hail you, Jesus.
Jesus.
Praise you, Jesus. We praise you this morning. We lift you up, Jesus. For you are King. Lord, you're seated on David's throne. You're ruling and reigning in our earth. And Lord, while we are at battle, while we might be at war, we have no need to fear because, Lord, you have overcome. The victory is yours today. Those of us who are in Christ have a reason to praise and have a confidence that the world doesn't have. And Lord, may that confidence compel us to be your hands and feet in the world around us. We praise you, Jesus. Lord, we do not fear this morning. We don't fear death because we have the hope of heaven waiting, that just the end of this life is really a homecoming for us. What a day that will be. What a day that will be. Jesus, come, you're here, Lord, but I pray, God, that you would continue now in service to change hearts and lives, to stir us to worship you, Lord, to bring us to a place of repentance, that we turn from our ways of sin and turn to you and turn to life and experience the abundant life you promised to give us. Jesus, we praise you. I want to take a moment, church, and just as we're in an attitude of prayer, to pray for a part of the world that just can't ever seem to find peace. Pray for the war that's happening in the Middle East right now. Pray for Israel. Pray for Iran. Iran is the second fastest growing church in the world. And we need to pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ there who may be undergoing persecution and may be caught up in the crossfire of all of this. Let's pray. Here's what I want us to pray for. I want us to pray that God would bring peace to this part of the world that just can't seem to find peace. Because this has been going on for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. Let's pray that God would bring peace into this part of the world that just can't seem to find peace. So we do pray that, Lord. We do pray that you would bring peace in the Middle East. God, that your peace would rest upon these people that have just constantly been at war and at conflict. God, that they would that they would find rest in you, Lord, that you would protect your church that's there. Lord, protect your people in all of the surrounding countries, but protect your church in Israel. Protect your church in Iran right now, Lord. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ, Lord. Lord, that you would just place a hedge of protection around them, Lord, that they would not be caught up in the crossfire of this war, but Lord, they would find security and they would find it and experience your peace in such a chaotic and crazy time. Lord, bring peace into this region of the world. Bring peace, we pray, Lord. God, you are in control of all of this. This does not surprise you. And we pray, God, that your will would be done and that through all of this chaos, through all of this darkness, through all of this turmoil, your name would be glorified. Your name would be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Can we just...
I have sent you. So raise your faith, raise your expectations. Know that the greater works are within your power. Because by my strength, by my spirit, everything is done.
Hallelujah.
So do not try to flex your muscles, but flex mine, says the Lord.
Hallelujah.
By faith, you will be victorious.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Yeah, we are at war. We are at war, but the Lord has won, and he has called us to join in his great work, to join in prayer, to join in prayer. That's where we win the battle, to join in prayer, to love our neighbors well. What we just experienced, Paul outlines in 1 Corinthians chapters 12 through 14, would be a prophetic word to the church, a word that's to uplift and encourage the body of Christ. And so be uplifted by that. Be encouraged. The victory is won. Let's join in with Jesus in this battle. Let's go and pray for our neighbors and pray for our communities that they would come to know Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, praise God. It's good to see you this morning. Man, what an awesome time of just worship and hearing from the Lord already. I know today is going to be a special day. It's already been a special day, but it's going to continue to be that. So we're so glad you're here this morning. My name's Daniel. I'm one of the pastors here. Welcome to Harvest. Why don't you take a moment and turn to somebody next to you? Just say hello to somebody. Introduce yourself to somebody you don't recognize, and let's welcome one another to church this morning. Welcome to all of you watching online with us today. We're super glad that you're here. We hate you can't be in the building with us, but we're grateful for the power of technology to be able to connect us and bring you into church with us today. My prayer is that you've been blessed by worship. My prayer is that you are blessed by the message we received from the Lord just a moment ago. And my prayer is you'll be blessed as we continue to study God's Word together. Pastor Rob continues our series on this battle that we're in, this war that we're in. And so let's join in with God today. Let's join in prayer for our neighbors, for our coworkers. Let's pray that those far from Christ would come to know him and be brought out of darkness and into his light. We're glad you're here with us today. Grab your Bible and a notebook and let's get ready to dig into God's word together as we continue to worship today. We're so glad you're here. All right, we're going to go ahead and move along worship the Lord for just a moment through our giving and through our generosity. Thank you for being a generous church and a faithful church in giving your tithe, your 10%, as outlined in Scripture, as well as above and beyond that when we're able to. You'll see on the screen behind me the different ways that you can give. As we give today, let's give with cheerful hearts, with glad hearts, as Paul instructs us to give. Worshiping the Lord as we give, not giving to seek something in return, but giving so that we can be a blessing to others. That's why we're giving, to be a blessing to others. And so I'm going to pray one more time, and then we'll look at this week's announcements. Lord, we pray that you would bless and multiply this offering, meet the needs of your kingdom. I pray, God, that it would touch needs physically as well as spiritually, and that it would reach to the ends of the earth. The good news of Jesus as we give today would be sent out into all the world. Hearts and lives would be changed. We thank you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's turn our attention to the screen and check out this week's announcements.
We're so glad you've joined us for church today at Harvest Christian Center, where we foster communities that pursue Jesus, become like him, and work to make him known. And if you are our guest, we do hope you were able to meet our connections team at the tent on the patio. If not, we have Get Connected cards in the seat back in front of you. We'd love it if you'd fill one of those out and then exchange that card for a packet of information at the Welcome Center or the tent, either place. Again, we're glad you've joined us for church. And if you'd like to learn more about Harvest Christian Center, what our vision and our values are, then you can take our DNA class. This happens every Sunday at 10:30 upstairs. The class is taught by Pastors Robert and Hannah. And this week we're on lesson three. Doesn't matter if you haven't had one and two, just jump up there for number three. And then you can circle back around for lessons one and two. Join us today. Just a quick reminder of the summer events we have for your teen and kids. Elementary and preschool VBS are coming up soon in June. You can register for those at the Children's Ministry kiosk. It's $20 through May 31st. After that, I think the price goes up. And then there's Kids Camp and Youth Camp in July. You can sign up for Kids Camp at the Children's Ministry kiosk. For Youth Camp, you register online at newmexicostudentministries.com/youthcamp. We're at Youth Camp number 4, and you'll want to search for Harvest Christian Center and make sure you sign your kids up for that one. We have a sign-up table in the lobby for volunteers needed for our Connections team, especially. We got 7 new volunteers for our tech team. I'm clapping for all of you. But I need more of Connections team members for the second service. So if this interests you at all, if you've taken the DNA class, then I would love it if you'd stop by that table, sign up for second service Connections team. If you can only do first service, that's okay too. We'll find a place for you there. And then also, we want more volunteers for our coffee bar. So if you enjoy the coffee bar and you're like, I can participate in that, sign up at the table in the lobby today. For all of you gardeners, we are going to plant the cross garden on Saturday, April 27th at 9 a.m. Bring your shovel, bring your gloves, and bring your wheelbarrow. And then for those of you who are not too into planting, but you want to participate somehow, we have a plant list in the lobby. So the city approves a certain number of plants, so many trees, so many bushes, and so many filler plants. We've put the filler plants out at the table in the lobby. You can sign up and purchase those if you want to participate, and then bring them on Saturday, April 27th. Make sure they're here by 9 a.m. so we can get those in the ground. And thanks for your help in advance. This afternoon, 5:30 to 7, our Protect Me Project team is going to do a presentation for all of you parents and grandparents who are interested. Protect Me Project, remember our missionary Carla Marquin, who was here last November, told us about this. She's the founder of this ministry that goes down into South America, into the schools, and teaches children how to protect themselves against trafficking, sex trafficking. And there's lots of great tools and education for you parents and grandparents to teach your children about sex and how they should be thinking about their bodies. So come this afternoon at 5:30, you'll learn a lot and you won't regret it. As you probably know by now, we are having a blood drive today. You can stop by the NPR and give blood. And then I want to share with you this certificate. So our military outreach team has faithfully been having meals once a month with our Chaplain Ryan and his unit out on base. And they gave us, actually the commanding officer of that unit gave us this certificate of appreciation for your outstanding support of this replacement center. Your volunteer work, active participation, and selfless service has positively impacted the lives of soldiers and families. Just wanted you to know it hasn't gone unnoticed by the powers that be on Fort Bliss that we've been there every month. So God bless you, team. We're going to keep doing it.
Isn't it wonderful to be able to serve people all around our city? And to be able to support our military. And I know Chaplain Ryan, who's sitting right over here, he said a couple of them, 2 for sure, maybe up to 7, they've been able to start a small group, all because of what we've been able to do in supporting our military in this particular unit. Isn't that wonderful? That is wonderful. That is good stuff. Well, it is good to see you today, church. How many of you are ready for a windy day? If it's windy at 5 a.m. in the morning, we're doomed. Anyways, it is good to see you as always, and we are in our series, War is at Hand, and this is a follow-up to last week's message, so Becoming Warriors, Part 2. And if you remember, 3 weeks ago now, would have been 2 weeks ago exactly, 3 Sundays ago, I shared a vision that the Lord had given me, that the Lord has come among us. I just want to recap this vision in case you weren't here one of those Sundays, or in case you haven't listened. I would encourage you to go back and listen to the message on April 7th. But I remember on March 23rd, I was out here in prayer with Dr. Dedergy and Dr. Inekwe, and just this image. I've never seen it before. It was a man on fire with a sword, and around him were others on fire, angels, like angels on fire with a sword, and I knew instantly it was the Lord. And he had come among us, and it was his army was here, and he is ready to go to battle and ready to go to war for our region of the world. And then as it progressed, that next day, the Lord prompted me to read Joshua chapter 5, verse 13. And the same image Joshua saw, he saw a man, this time not with a sword, with his hand on the hilt of the sword, but he had the sword in his hand. He was ready to rock and roll. And the statement, the commander of the Lord's army has come among you. And then that following Wednesday, I had received a prophetic word from Jason right down here. And he's the one who just spoke out, confirming it. And it was, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has roared over his people. He is ready for battle. And so these three words confirm it. And when the Lord speaks in threes to you, you better believe he's confirming something. And I felt it was so important that it wasn't just for me, it's for us as a church. And that first Sunday, I shared that with you, and we had a time of response, and I believe that we just needed to seek the Holy Spirit and ask for a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And about 90% of you as a church responded to that, and we were able to anoint each other with oil, and essentially that was the enlisting message saying, I want to be a part of what God is doing. I want to join the army of the Lord for whatever he's going to do over El Paso. Remember last week I shared with you a vision that Fabian had and that he had shared with me on April 7th just about why we're going to war. And we're going to war over the lost souls, the people who are trapped in sin and trapped in darkness in this region of the world. Like, we're going to battle to see people saved. That's why we're going to battle. That's a reason to go to war, isn't it? Seek the well-being of people, but this isn't a physical war. This is a spiritual battle. So we don't fight with guns, and we don't fight the way the world fights. We don't fight with human agendas, human thought processes. No, we fight in the Spirit. But first and foremost, if we're going to fight in the Spirit, we ourselves have to learn to walk with God. And coming to Joshua chapter 1, we opened it up. Joshua told Moses, be strong and courageous, for I am with you. And I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And at the bedrock of how we have to fight this spiritual war, to see people come to Christ, to pray against the spiritual darknesses and the principalities of the air, it starts with, you got to be in God. You got to be in Christ. If we are called to do the ministry, which we are called to do the ministry, well, it starts with having that close nearness with God, and I'm not going to be strong in myself. I'm not going to go about this my own way. I'm going to go about this God's way, knowing that if I go about it God's way, the victory that he said and has prepared for us will be ours. And so last week we talked about being strong and courageous, and now I want to talk about the next element of that, which really it is, how we actively become strong and courageous. But before I share that, this last week there was an individual in a small group, not my small group, and they were super excited 2 weeks ago. And they came down, they were anointed, wanting the fullness of the Holy Spirit in their lives, the gift of the Holy Spirit that God pours out upon his church, and which is God himself living and dwelling within us. And this individual wanted that, came down here, but then left feeling overwhelmed. I'm curious, when we're thinking about all this, is anyone else like, yeah, I'm a little overwhelmed because I don't know what to do? Anybody? I mean, you don't have to raise your hand, but maybe I see some hands. And it's like, what am I supposed to do now? I've been anointed with oil. I'm supposed to pray in the Spirit. But how do I even pray to begin with? How do I do this? How do I be strong in the Lord? How do I do this if I feel so overwhelmed in the process? And I want to take a moment before we even get into the scripture. I want to just remind us of the battle plan that God has given us. And really, you could even call it a battle cry. And it's what God has been putting in our hearts for the last 2 years. This isn't new stuff. God has been preparing this moment. And he's been preparing our hearts for the last 2 years, helping us set some things in order that we needed to as a church. And he makes it clear what our battle plan and our battle cry is to be. But before I even share that, I want to share one other thing. The most important thing when it comes to stepping into this fight and serving the Lord in this capacity is you can't expect to fight a spiritual war by yourself. I want to make sure you know that. This is before we get into any points for the message or any of those things. You can pray at home, but especially if you're a new Christian, like if you don't know how to pray and how to seek God and really how to read the Word, we've got to fight a spiritual war in community. I mean, that's how it's always been from the beginning of time. The church has gathered together. The body of Christ has come together and sought God together, prayed together, read the scriptures together, like did everything together because they understood it was only in community that they would be able to deal with the things that they had to deal with in the world around them. And it's the same for us. So if you're feeling overwhelmed, like what do I do? The first thing to do is to be a part of the body of Christ. Not just showing up to church. I mean, get involved in the prayer ministry. Get involved in a small group. Get involved with others in the church, serving with one another. We've got to rub shoulders. And that's where then, if you feel overwhelmed, you don't know how to pray, you'll learn how to pray in community while other people are praying. Like if you want to know how to pray in the Spirit, come to a prayer meeting. You'll learn how to pray in the Spirit. You might not know how to do it right away, but you'll begin to learn it. You want to know how to read your Bible? Join a small group where they're opening up the Word and studying it and reading it together. Then you'll begin to learn how to study and read the Bible correctly. You want to learn how to serve and to walk in humility? Well, serve in a ministry. And it's a wonderful practice for serving each other in the body of Christ that equips us to go serve people in the world 5 days a week. But it's in community that this happens. Not in isolation. Even more so, I want to talk right to whoever's watching today. If you can't come to church, if you're a trucker, if you're sick or whatever it is, okay, that's one thing. But if it's just out of laziness, and they all say, ooh, but they've maybe been done in your shoes too, but if it's out of laziness or I don't want to come, you're missing out on the community of the body of Christ. We need to be together in community because remember, it's not about this building. Christ lives in his people. And we get to know Christ more when we're around each other. And so I want to remind us of our battle plan that we have as a church. At Harvest, this is our vision statement. At Harvest, we foster communities that do three things: pursue Jesus, become like Jesus, and work to make him known. So I just want to real quickly give you some really practical tools and steps. If you're feeling overwhelmed, and how do I do this? Here are some basic steps. One, pursue Jesus together. You have to pursue Jesus together, and there's really two ways, as a church, we think about this. One, we want to encourage everybody, and really, it's not an encouragement. If you're a part of the church, this should just kind of be your heartbeat, but make it a habit to join together with other believers every single week. I mean, of course, we get sick. Sometimes you have to work on a certain day, on a Sunday, and you can't, or you go out of town. But don't pull the I went to sleep late card on Saturday. Don't pull the I'm not feeling, we just woke up a little late. No, there's got to be this mentality like we have to gather together weekly, regularly, in small groups and in our services. We've got to gather together as the body of Christ. We have to. There's no other option for us. Because it's in community that we really get to encounter Christ. Of course, individually, but community is so important to the body of Christ. Two, we pursue Jesus in prayer. You know, we're really building upon our prayer ministry. We have, I want to make sure you hear this and write these things down. We have pre-service prayer at 8:30, right before this church, this service. We have pre-service prayer at 10:30, right before second service, where we just, it's 5 to 10 people, we gather together right down here, and then we begin to walk the room. There's a key scripture that we're kind of focusing on, and we're praying for you that are in this service right now. seeking God together and learning to pray, learning to pray Scripture, learning to pray in the Spirit. And that's just on Sundays. We have Wednesday noon prayer, which I know not everyone can because of work schedules. But we're having more and more people come. And we're for an hour. We seek God. Different pastors lead that. Different scriptures. We seek God. We believe. Sometimes people are speaking out, and there's a sense of a word on them, and they share it with us and directs how we're going. We pray for healing. We pray for families. We pray for all kinds of different things. Sometimes we down here weeping and just worshiping the Lord. All kinds of different things. But there's just, like, we've got to gather together and pray. And then about eight weeks ago, Dr. Dedity, Dr. Nekwa, and myself started praying Saturday at 5 p.m. And sometimes I can't make that, sometimes they can't, but there's always someone here. And just encourage you to join us on that day from 5 to 6, 1 hour, preparing our hearts for Sunday, praying for the church, praying in the Spirit, praying, worshiping the Lord, praying through Scripture, just seeking God right out here in the front of our building. Just pressing into Him. Like, if you want to be the type of person who's pursuing Jesus, these are the things that you're going to say, you know what? I don't need to make this overwhelming. It's simple. I need to make it a habit to get to church and weekly gather with the body of Christ. And I need to seek God in prayer. And, you know, I don't know how to do it by myself right now. And sometimes I don't feel like doing it by myself. So I'm going to make it my goal to join this church in prayer during one of these times, to learn how to seek God in prayer. If you don't know how to pray in the Spirit, join us to pray. Join us in one of these services. You will learn to pray in the Spirit. So we pursue Jesus, but we do it together. We become like Jesus together. Actually, before I even move on from that, I want to just kind of share. You know what I'd really like to see? This is the game, or the end aim for our prayer ministry. I'd love it to be that Monday through Thursday, multiple times throughout the day, we have maybe 4 hours where our church is open to pray, and there's 100 people every single day coming to seek God. And where that's roughly 400 different people every week, throughout the week, not at one of our regular services, at a prayer service, where we are just seeking God together. I guarantee you, when that happens in our church, by the way, if you've been enlisted, you've got responsibilities. I'm just saying that. But when that happens, I guarantee you, things will break in the spirit realm. Things that we can't comprehend, things will break in your life that you've always wanted to break. Things will break in our kids. We'll see prodigal sons and daughters coming back to Christ. We'll see things in our community. We'll be like, why are these things happening? Well, it's because there's a group of people seeking God together every single day, drawing near to Him, expecting for God to show up, and He shows up. That's what we really want to see, just this hunger for prayer, praying for the lost, praying against the demonic, all that kind of stuff. But then here's the second thing. Becoming like Jesus. Of course, we do it by ourselves, but we really do it together. We got to do it together. We have to become like Jesus together. We have to rub on each other. We got to rub shoulders with each other. We've got to get the tough pieces of our lives, our struggles, our bitterness, our anxieties, our fears, all these things. When we're with each other, we help each other. It's like a good family. They hate each other sometimes, but they love each other more often, and then they're really rubbing on each other, making each other smooth and stronger and healthier. If you want to become like Jesus, join a group. Join a small group. Join one of our classes. Join one of our felt needs groups. And in these groups, we have groups on Wednesday nights. Pastors teach groups on Wednesday nights, plus some of our council members, some other individuals, men's groups, women's groups, couples groups. And we've got plenty of groups throughout the week. Find one that fits your schedule. They're an hour to an hour and a half, and we go over the message. We go over the sermon together, and it gives you the opportunity to dig into it a little more because, believe it or not, I cannot exhaust all there is to teach on one subject in about 50 minutes. It's impossible. And then you have questions. And some of you leave with probably more questions than answers, which that's a good thing because then it's an opportunity to grow and to discover the Word of God. But it's in small groups you get to really dig into that kind of stuff. It's in the small group where you get to see it's not just these passages I'm reading, but that there's other passages that speak to the exact same issues. It's in small group where the Lord is speaking to you that you can share those things and grow and learn. It's in small groups where we pray for one another. It's in small groups where we become like Jesus. It's so important to be connected to the body of Christ, growing with him. And it's in the group, when you're learning this in the group, then it equips you even more. When you see someone else struggling with the same thing that you're struggling with, but yet he's doing everything in his power to live faithfully to God, it empowers you and encourages you to do the exact same thing. When you know someone is dealing with the same weakness you deal with, say anger, you guys can now text each other and be like, hey, how you doing? You can pray for each other. You can learn to hold your tongue. It's like, hey, I'm holding my tongue because I bet somewhere today he's having to hold his tongue, and we're going to follow Jesus together. We're going to do this together. And then serve in the church. Find a place in ministry here at the church, and we need help. But you don't just serve in the church just to serve in the church, because let's think about what the Bible says. Jesus said, I did not come to be served, but to serve. And what better people to serve than each other, the sons and daughters of God? And to learn to serve one another, and it builds humility in our lives. It teaches us many different things. It allows us to become more like Christ. But then it also helps us to practice. Serving one another is practice for learning to serve people that are far more challenging to serve in this world and who may not ever say thank you to us. There may be some people in this room who aren't very good at acknowledging when someone serves them. It's a side note. But serve. Find a place to serve. Again, if you feel like, what do I do? Everything is ultra overwhelming right now. Of how do I fight this battle? I'm giving you the basic steps, super practical things that'll help you to fight the spiritual war God wants us to fight in community. Then lastly, we work to make Christ known together. Of course we do this as individuals. You go to your workplace, no other Christians are necessarily there. So you're praying for your coworkers and praying for your next door neighbors. And there's plenty of people God has given us to share Christ with. But it's as a church and reach. This is reach. Everything we're about. Giving to missionaries. Seeing the kingdom of God expand around the world. To the military in Fort Bliss. And being able to serve on Fort Bliss and to minister to our military soldiers. Going to Medano Heights and blessing this community and men and women and families and children. Chaparral, which is now turned into a church plant, is that very thing. By the way, last week, this church had their first two people come to Christ. Isn't that wonderful? I think it was either a 15 or 16-year-old boy and a man who the week before was invited, but he was walking his dogs at the park, but he came back the next week, and then he gave his life to Jesus. But get involved in our outreaches. Get involved in what we're able to do with our community. Serving our community with our hands, our feet, our words, with our prayers, with actions, in every way possible, we want to make Christ known in our region of the world. We want to make him known in our nation. We want to make him known in the world. And, you know, even in our generosity, the gospel's free, but it does cost a lot of money to take the gospel around the world. And that's why we're generous above and beyond the tithe, because you know what? We are a church who is invested in people coming to salvation. We are invested into planting churches where people meet Jesus. We're invested into our missionaries who have been called by God to different places and regions of the world. We're invested in our Christian nonprofits in this region of the world who are making Christ known and serving in different capacities. And we want to give generously to these people. These are the basic things. If you feel overwhelmed and don't want to know what to do, it's like you're excited, but you're overwhelmed, pursue Jesus together. Make it a habit to come to church every week unless you can't. Join, be a part of the prayer ministry. Join us at pre-service prayer, noon prayer, or Saturday prayer at 5:30 p.m. Learn to pray. If you want to become like Jesus, join a group. We're doing it together. Growing together, reading the scriptures, praying together. Join one on Wednesdays or join one during the week. Serve in the church. Get involved in a ministry. Give up some of that time, a couple hours, just to be able to serve one another in the body of Christ. If you want to make Christ known, we do it together. Get involved in the doors God has already opened up for us to be able to serve and to reach out to our community. And we give generously. I actually want to say one other thing about generosity. I shared this yesterday. We had a church council meeting. I was sharing this with them. You know, studies show and the stats show, and I'm sure our church is no different. We haven't done it by any means. But about 20% of the church financially supports 100% of the church. That's the tithe. We're talking about the tithe. I'm not talking about reach for this moment, just the tithe. Ours could be a little above that. Ours could be right on the money, or it could be a little below that. Yet God has provided all that we need through that 20%. If all of God's people in this room would say, you know what? I'm going to trust God with the tithe. What we would be capable of doing would absolutely blow our brains. I want to just talk about this for a minute. And I'm not talking about reach. I'm just talking about tithe. In fact, I probably wouldn't even ask for anything above your tithe. I'd tell you, be generous, but go be generous to your next door neighbor because we don't need any more money. That's kind of the place we would be at. We would be able to get out of debt within a year. $4 million gone in a heartbeat. We would be able to, our overhead wouldn't increase. Like, of course, every now and then you have to bring on another staff member or whatever it may be, but our overhead would stay right about where it is, which is about $2 million. That's what it takes to make this church happen and make all our different campuses happen, to make things run on a regular basis with our four campuses. Our overhead wouldn't increase that much. But you know what? We know it would increase. The fact that we're not able to give $800,000 to missions, but probably more like $7 to $8 million to missions. Think about this for a second. If everyone tithed in the church, if everyone said, you know what, we're going to be faithful to the 10% God has called us to, but we wouldn't just, that would be our church plants. We would be able to plant churches. We wouldn't even have to bat an eye at it. If God's calling us to do it, we would just need God to bring the person who's going to lead the church plant, but we would always have the money for it. We would be the type of church that could go to the Christian nonprofits in our town and say, how much debt do you have? Here's a check. You don't have any more debt. Like, that's what we could do. We could go to other churches who are faithfully serving God. We could go to them and say, how much debt do you have? Here's a check. It's paid for. You're done. You don't need to worry about your debt anymore. I've always wanted to do this. I've wanted to be, most churches are always complaining to their elected city officials. And, you know, we could look at our governments and say mishandling of funds and all this kind of stuff, but we could go to our mayor and we could go to our city council members and tell them, hey, we have $500,000 right here. Is there a special project you have, a park, a school that needs a little upgrade? Is there something that we can do for you in this city? No strings attached. Here's the money. We could tell our city, what would that do? What would that tell our city council members and our elected officials? There's a church who cares. There's a church who is faithfully following God and who cares and wants to be deeply invested into our community. You know what else we could do? I think we would have enough money. We'd probably have $1 million benevolence fund that when people in our, and of course there'd be real, real strong controls on this, but people in our church who get sick and have medical bills, $50,000 medical bills, we could pay them. Would that be incredible? If we could do that as a church, for one another as our brothers and sisters in Christ. Wouldn't it be incredible that every person in this church, someone who passes away, I think about Charlie Wasson, his wife passed away, wouldn't it be incredible if we could just write a check for all the funeral expenses for every person in this church who has someone who's passed away? Wouldn't it be? Like, that's what we would be capable of doing as a church if we said, you know what, we're all going to say, as faithful Christians, we're going to be faithful to the tithe. Reach would be, we wouldn't have a separate reach fund. Reach would just come out of the tithe. We're giving money away, just serving God, just being able to do what God wants us to do because we are being faithful to the Lord. I want to encourage you in that generosity. I just inspire you in that. And you know, your tithe, I know it's a 10%. Cut back on Starbucks. Cut back on whatever else it may be. so that we can pay medical bills for someone in our church and as a collective whole. I mean, who knows what would be possible? But anyways, the battle plan, the simple steps, pursue Jesus together, become like Jesus together, and work to make Christ known together. If you're feeling overwhelmed and don't know what to do, do these things with us together. Get involved and be connected to us. On that note, why don't you open up to Joshua chapter 1. We're going to pick up where we were last week, and all of this, of course, ties together. Joshua 1, 1 through 9, just to remind us of this passage, says this: After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give them, to the Israelites. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country, to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. And this is what we're going to focus on today, so really pay attention to these next two verses. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave to you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. So, Lord, we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you for your Spirit that is evident in this room. I pray even now, just through worship, through the Word, the prophetic Word that was spoken, through just even simple instruction of if we're feeling overwhelmed, this is what we should do. And now as we open the Word to be encouraged, to be instructed, to be guided even more, Lord, speak to us as you wish. Direct us, challenge us, shape us, encourage us. And in Jesus' mighty name, all of God's people said, amen. So I want to take a look at this, because last week we talked about being strong and very courageous. But you want to know how to be strong and very courageous? It's evident, or the evidence of being strong and courageous, obedience. The evidence that you are strong and courageous in the Lord, or that you are be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power, it's by the obedience to the Word of God. And for us as Christians, it's obedience to the teachings of Christ, which the law and the Old Testament point to Jesus. Everything points to Jesus. So if we would just keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and be obedient to Christ, we would be obedient, we would be prosperous and successful, and we would clearly be evidently strong and courageous in God. So today we're going to talk about what is it to be obedient to the Lord. So I want to focus right here. Here's the first point. Obey all the law. God told Joshua, be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. A couple things I want us to note from here. I want to make sure you see it. It does not say, be careful to obey some of the law my servant Moses gave you. No, God is expecting Joshua to obey everything he's asked him to obey. But the question is, what is the law? Because that may be. And the law you would find in the Old Testament, you're going to find it in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. It consists of 600, there are 613 laws in those four books that teach Israel how to follow God. Teach them how to be separate from other cultures. Teach them how to be in the presence of God. But this is, when it boils down, this is what the law is. The law is the way and the wisdom of God given to Israel so that Israel could live right before God and God could be with them. Deuteronomy 4, 1 through 2 says this: Now Israel, hear the decrees and laws I am about to teach you. Follow them. Did you notice that? Follow them. That's like the way. This is, if you follow them, this idea of the path, follow them so that you may live and may go in and take possession of the land the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving you. Do not add to what I command you and do not subtract from it, but keep the commands of the Lord your God that I may give you. Deuteronomy 4:6 says this. We just go down a little bit. See, I have taught you decrees and the laws as the Lord my God commanded me. This is Moses talking. So that you may follow them in the land you are entering to take possession of it. Observe them carefully, for this will show your, what does that say? Wisdom and understanding to the nations. You will hear, who will hear about all these decrees and say, surely this great nation is wise and understanding people. So at the heart of it, Joshua is being told that the evidence of his strength and courage is in his obedience to the law, which is the way and the wisdom of God. It's the way to life. It's the way to God himself. And it's the wisdom of God given to the people that if they follow him, they will be right before God. Joshua will be right before God and right with everyone else around him. And so with just that basic understanding of the law, do Christians, here's the question we need to ask, do Christians need to follow the law? Well, it's a no, but. No, but there's some things we need to understand. And so let's now look at what Jesus says about the law. In Matthew verse 5:17, this is at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount, basically. Jesus says this, do not think I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Jesus has fulfilled the law. No man in heaven or on earth has ever been able to keep all 613 laws, and it's proof of the sinfulness of humanity. But Jesus has come, and he has fulfilled the law. Amen. This is a big deal, that if we would keep our eyes fixed on Jesus and watch him and live with him and let his way and his wisdom, which is the same way and wisdom of God that's in the law, just explained maybe a little differently for us, if we would follow his ways and his wisdom, you'll have fulfilled the law through Jesus. So just follow Jesus. This is the end aim for Christians. Follow Jesus. Matthew 22, 37 through 40 says this. Jesus, someone asked him, what's the greatest commandment of the law? He said this, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. So, if you would just, in your heart, if we, I should say, would love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, our whole being, and love our neighbor as ourselves, then we've fulfilled the law. And that's the example Jesus has given us. He is the ultimate embodiment of love himself, that if we would follow him, we too fulfill this. John 14:15, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he's getting ready to talk to them about the Holy Spirit and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit and the gift he's getting ready to give them. But he leads with this. He says, if you love me, keep my commands. So if I love Jesus, like love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. If I love Jesus, I'm going to keep his teachings and his commands. Which don't discredit the law, but actually Jesus fulfills them, and through Christ then I fulfill the law. And then you have Romans 13. Now this is moving on to Paul's writings on the law. Romans 13 verse 8, Paul says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves one another has fulfilled the law. That's to love our neighbor as ourselves. I want to just give one clarifying thought here. I'm mentioning love in three of these passages. This is not love as defined by our culture. This is love as defined by God, because God is love. And so a lot of times we need to make sure we have a proper understanding of the love of God in order to do these well. We can't just love like the world does and think that we're fulfilling this. You're not going to be fulfilling this. And so as a follower of Jesus, we have no obligation to follow the 613 laws of Moses, but we must follow the teachings of Jesus. We're getting ready in 2 weeks, we're getting ready to move into our Sermon on the Mount series, which is like the fundamental teachings. It's a retelling of the law according to Christ. It makes it way tougher, actually, is what he does. So we must follow the teachings of Jesus because his way in wisdom is the same way in wisdom of God who gave us the law, because Jesus is God. The difference is Christ has fulfilled the law and is the perfection of it. If we obey Christ as Joshua obeys the law, we too will be right before God and with those around us. I want to make sure you understood that. Jesus said in another passage, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So if you follow Jesus, who is the way, and out of that, he leads us to life, and he is the embodiment of all truth, which wisdom points us to truth. If we would follow Jesus, we'll know God our Father, and we'll be right with God himself. So draw near to Jesus. Obey all the law. Obey Christ. But then he goes on and he tells Joshua, he says, make sure to obey all the law that I gave my servant Moses. Then he says, do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Leads us to the second thought. Do not turn from the law. You know, up until this point, if you'd read the story, especially in Exodus, but even Leviticus and Numbers, up until this point, Israel has consistently struggled with idolatry and sin. They have not done a good job of faithfully following God who just rescued them from Israel. And God even said, you shall have no other gods before me. That's the first command of the Ten Commandments. That's the first of the law. That's the first command of the entire law. But consistently, they couldn't do it. They couldn't fulfill it. They turned and they worshiped other gods. They even when Moses was on Mount Sinai and they could see the presence of God on the mountain, they're worshiping a golden calf, saying that this God rescued them out of Israel. Like, they just can't get it. And this is what God is telling Joshua, don't turn from me. He's not just saying don't turn from the law, because if you turn from the law, it's clear that you've also turned from God. If we won't follow the teachings of Christ, it's evident that we're not fully submitted to Christ and there's something else in our life we're following. So he's saying, make sure you do not deviate to the left or to the right of the law that I've given you, of the wisdom and the way of God, because this is how you'll be right with me and those around me. Don't deviate from it. So I tell you, church, don't deviate from the teachings of Christ. Don't deviate from Christ so that you may be right with him and right with others. But the problem is, idolatry is a constant temptation in our lives. We're always looking, is there a better way? Even when we're faithfully following Jesus, we're saying, I'm still looking. Oftentimes we're looking other places. Maybe that's a better way, or maybe I do it this way, or get all kinds of different things. And you know, we're all going to worship something. And even Paul says it a little different. He says, you're going to be a slave to Jesus, or you're going to be a slave to sin, but you're going to be a slave to something. I'd rather be a slave to the one who wants to set me free from sin and death itself and give me hope and life and joy rather than a slave to the one who's going to keep me in death. I'd rather worship the one who has good things for me and not the one who's going to destroy me. We're all going to worship something in this world. And what's interesting is that what we worship becomes an idol or a godlike thing in our lives. And that idol has its own way and its own wisdom, and has its own way that it's expecting you to live, that you have to live. If you're going to be for this, and we got some examples, if you're going to live for this, if you want to aim for success in your work career, you're going to live with this way and this wisdom, and ultimately it's going to mean the death of you or the death of something else in your life. the death of your family, the death of a relationship with your sons and daughters. You're going to lose everything in the process of being successful in the eyes of our work. You guys know what I'm talking about? I want to give you an example of the idolatry of sex and sexual immorality. If we're going to be, which our culture pretty much has a really well-rounded understanding of the idolatry of sexual immorality. And, you know, if you're going to live for sex and the pluralistic idea of sex, sex before marriage, the multiple gender ideas, all these different things, abortion, all this different stuff, just we're going to live it up, we're going to do whatever we want to do. It comes with, there's a whole way and a wisdom to how you have to organize your life. You have to organize your life around this stuff. You're thinking about it constantly, you dwell on it. You tell me one young man who can't get porn out of his brain. Yeah, you're dead silent there. I mean, as a young man who dealt with it, when you're caught up in sexual things, you can't get it out of your brain. You're consumed by it. Everything and everyone becomes a sexual object. Everything can bring arousal. It's always about it, and it's no different for women. How you organize your life, you're always thinking about the one-night stand, or you go on a date, your immediate thought is, well, at some point we got to have sex. Is it date one, date two, date three? How is this all going to play out? And this is what blows my brain, is that it always somehow leads to death. And it may not be your death, but it's the death of the unborn. The 70 billion children that we've put upon the altar of Molech and abortion itself. Like, it's the way and the wisdom of sexual immorality. The death of yourself. Like, you, young man, or young woman, caught up in porn, you have no drive to do anything else in this world anymore. You've lost your personality. You've lost everything because porn has, and masturbation has just sucked the life right out of you. We've lost the mutilation of our sons and daughters upon on the transgenderism. We wave their genitals on the white flag saying, hey, look how amazing we are, and we've just sacrificed our children upon the altar of death. Like, sexual immorality has its own way and its own wisdom, and someone's gonna die. It's gonna be you, and it's gonna be a whole lot of people around you. Greed. Let's think about this for money. Because money is, there's greed and all of it. Like, there's an idolatry of money in this country. We're the most prosperous country in the world. Of course we deal with it. We want to propagate the stock market. And I want to make sure something's really clear. Sex is a good thing seen in the proper light of God. So sex is no longer the idol. It's a gift from God. Money is a good thing seen in the proper light of God, but it's not the idol. God is the one we worship. We don't bow down to money. We don't bow down to sex. And everything is framed properly, and those don't lead to death. It's when these things become idols that they lead to death. So let's think about greed. Well, first off, when we buy cheap stuff in the world and, you know all this kind of stuff, we could very easily be involved in you know, child slavery, just because we want more stuff constantly. That's just a simple thing, and that's a form of death, but we don't necessarily see that. But let's talk about greed and what it can do to your own family. When we become greedy and, you know, we want a nice home, we want nice things, and maybe, I mean, wanting those things isn't wrong, but when we allow the drive to have another zero in the bank account, the drive of success, the drive of all these different things, what does it lead to? It leads to broken marriages. It leads to broken relationships. It leads to moms and dads not even being home with the children they have. Absentee fathers and absentee mothers, when our pride and joy, like, children are a gift from God. The family unit is decimated. We move our kids from point A to point B, all because of our career, with disregard to how is this going to affect my children's life. And then we're able to retire, and we've got 7 figures or 8 figures in our bank accounts and our retirement plans and our 403Bs. But yet, we're not even faithful to God with our own tithe. And it's all about us. It's about me. And I don't care if there's human trafficking or slave labor in this world. I don't care about those things. I care about what I can get. I don't care if there's someone in my church that has medical bills that if we all were faithful to God, maybe we could do something about that. I'm just going to get another Frappuccino today. And we just, that inward focused nature of money, I got to have it. And then money drives us nuts. We love it when we have it, and we hate it when we don't have it. And we loathe those who have it, and we despise those who don't have it. We glorify those who know how to make money, and we criminalize those, not necessarily, but the general idea, those who live in poverty. And even in the Christian culture, we come across this idea, well, if you're poor, you're probably not blessed by God. And it's like, no, that's not how this works. That's not what the Lord teaches. There's plenty of people who live in poverty who are faithfully following Jesus and are not controlled by the idolatry of money and are living in a more intimate, close relationship with Christ. But here's the big one of idolatry. It's the idolatry of self, which really breeds sexual immorality. It breeds the greed and all kinds of things. It's the say, no, I don't bow down to money. I bow down to myself. That I myself am the ultimate rule and law for my own life. There's nothing greater. It brings this sense of I can decide what's right and wrong for myself. If it hurts someone, if it brings death to someone else, I really don't care. But you want to know what happens with that? I believe that's the biggest reason we have an epidemic of mental illness in our society. It's the idolatry of self. You can be whatever you want to be. You can do whatever you want to do. You can live however you want to live. And that breeds anxiety. Yes. It breeds fear. It breeds all kinds of different things that really cause us to no longer be able to live. And it stifles us. And depression and all these different things come upon us. And we bring death to ourselves and we bring death to others in the process. All because we want to worship something other than the creator of the universe, the savior of the world who has come to give us a better way. And so God is telling Joshua, don't deviate from the law I've given you. Don't deviate from the wisdom, the way and the wisdom that I've given you. Because if you deviate from it, you're going to go worship something else. And it's going to give you its own ways and its own wisdom, and that's going to lead you to death. But if you stay faithful to Jesus, you'll live and you'll have life to the fullest and you'll find freedom and you'll be blessed by God. I want you to see this. If you look at it, do not turn from it to the right or to the left that you may be successful wherever you go. Jesus says, the thief has come to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that you may have life and life to the full. Idols in this world are going to steal, kill, and destroy, but Christ is going to give you life. You know, we live in a more and more pagan culture than we ever have in America. We don't maybe call it pagan. The idea of paganism is dead because Christ, the gospel's gone all around, but the idols are still very present. So how do we, as Christians, how do we guard against idolatry? I just want to read one quick passage before we move on. Hebrews chapter 12, 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, those who were faithful to the end, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition for sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. One, deal with the sin that you deal with. Own them in the presence of God. Get rid of them. Throw them off. Repent of them. You deal with some forms of idolatry, Own it. Say, God, idolatry's in my heart. I deal with money. I deal with greed. I want this. I want this. I'm putting this at your feet because really, I don't want my eyes fixed on an idol. I want my eyes fixed on you, Jesus. Because I want everything you have for me. I want to run the race that's marked out for me. So fix your eyes on Jesus. And on that note, I want to bring us to the last thought of this passage. And I'm going to try to land the plane really quickly because I see my time. Meditate on the law. So we had obey all the law, don't turn from the right or the left of it, and meditate on the law. Joshua, the Lord tells Joshua, keep the book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. And then he reiterates this. Then you will be prosperous and successful. I want to read to you Psalm 1. Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, who meditates on his law day and night. Is this like a retelling, a poetic retelling of exactly what God just told Joshua? That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Not so the wicked and not so the idolater. They are like chaff that the wind blows around. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. As a follower of Jesus, we have to get into the Word of God. You have to, and remember, the entire Bible, Old Testament, Gospels, and New Testament, all point back to Jesus. So it's this idea, we need Jesus, like, in us. We need this Word. If I could put this in my mouth, I'd put it in my mouth right now to just show you what I'm talking about. Like, we've got to get the Word of God in us. We've got to get Jesus in us, the teachings of Christ in us, but not just head knowledge, heart knowledge, hand knowledge, strength knowledge, all, like, it's got to come out of us. The Word of God has to be so in us that we are dwelling and meditating on it and speaking it, praying it, studying it, that it just becomes our life. And then we are like trees planted by streams of water, which are fruitful, healthy, whole, and whose leaves don't wither. Whatever happens, this is our reality as the righteous. Synonyms of meditate are to consider. So consider the Word of God. Deliberate. Deliberate. Talk to other people. Deliberate in your mind. Deliberate with the Lord in prayer. Talk to Him about things that are hard to understand. Ask God for wisdom. Read the Proverbs. Read the Psalms. Read the entire Old Testament, the prophets, the law, the Gospels, the New Testament. Read the whole book. Mull it over in your mind. Like, you know, that's like chewing. That's like eating a good steak. You guys know I like steak because every time I bring up this analogy, it's always steak. It's either steak or fish is the other one. It's like, you just chew on it. You're mulling it over, studying, thinking. There's a scripture you can't get out of your mind. You just continually bringing that up, praying, talking to God about it, letting it sink deep into your heart, letting it change you. Ponder it. Ponder the things of God. Ponder the glory of God. Ponder the mysteries of God. Ponder the things we understand and the things we don't understand about God. Ponder the stories of Jesus. Ponder what He's done. Ponder His teachings. And how does that apply to me? Reflect on it. Look yourself in the mirror. Is the what's in the Scriptures, is it in me? Is it not in me? Right. All those different things. That's what it is to meditate. It's not these contrite, I'm going to take 3 minutes right here and go through this and then forget about it the rest of the day. No, it's getting it in you and letting it change you. So here's some really, to close this out, some really practical things. Two things on Scripture. Every Christian needs a systematic approach to reading the Bible. Every Christian should be reading the Bible. And you don't read it like this. Let me tell you, you don't do this. Okay, this is where I'm going to start, and this is what the Lord's telling me. No, that's not how to read the Bible. No, you start, I'd encourage everyone to start in the Gospels. Read Jesus. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Start in Matthew. Get through that first chapter. It's a wonderful chapter, but if you're new to it, it's hard to understand. It's a genealogy. And then begin to just read Jesus. You don't have to understand it all. Do you understand every book, the entirety of every book you read? No. Just start reading it. And when you don't understand it, write it down. This is why it's valuable to be in small groups, because when you don't understand something, you can talk about it. Process out these things. Study the Word of God. And you need to, and this brings us to the second point, you need to read and study the Bible in community, especially as a new believer. If you are new to Christ or in the last year, or maybe you've never really studied the Word of God, you need this, whether you've been following Jesus for a while. Because when we don't do it in community, we will think the Bible says whatever we think it should say. But the Bible does not say whatever we think it should say. The Bible says something, and it's got a point. And in community, we can begin to learn how to rightfully read the Word of God and study it. Prayer. Learn to pray. Learn to meditate. And when we pray, I want you to think about an upward, an inward, and an outward mindset. So the best thing to do is to pray Scripture. And what I mean by that, of course, you can just pray what's on your mind, but you're always going to be praying the will of God when you're praying Scripture. Go to the Psalms. They are the prayers of the Bible. And just start in Psalm number 1 and read it and then pray through it and let it soak into your life. Let it apply to you. But upward, inward, and outward is first, let the Scripture that you're reading, that you're praying through, point you to God, to who He is, His faithfulness, His goodness, whatever it may be. But then after a moment, after, I don't know, 3 minutes, 2 minutes, however long, then let it go inward. It's like, okay, Lord, what does this mean for me? How do I need to apply this to this my life? And shape me. And you begin to pray Psalm 1 into your life. Lord, may I be like a tree planted by streams of water. Lord, help me to meditate on the law of day and night. May Christ be in me. Lord, if there is any sin in me, show me. I don't want to walk with any sinners. I want to delight in you. I want to walk with you. And you just begin to pray and sit with the Lord in those things. And then outward, pray that very psalm for others. Pray that for your community. Pray that for your church. Pray that for your mom, your dad, your kids, whoever it may be. And then here's another thought. Prayer is talking to God, and it comes in a lot of forms. And I don't want you to stress it. Like, how do I know I'm praying right? If you're talking to God, you're doing it. And you could be talking to God while you mow the lawn, while you're eating food. You can even be talking to God while you're on social media. You could talk to God anywhere, anyhow, anytime. And it's just this, you can worship God while you're watching TV. And you can praise Him and glorify Him in those moments. And just let your life just be this constant outflow of just talking to God. And then here's the third one when it comes to prayer. We need to pray in community. That's really how you're going to learn to pray well. And you're going to grow in your prayer life. Just as we need to be in small groups, we need to be in prayer community. Here's a simple starting point. If you don't read your Bible and pray, you're not doing any of those things. Do the 5 times 3. Or 3 by 5, I should say. 3 times a day, take 5 minutes to be with God. Start with that and then let it build, because my suspicion is as you do that, you're going to want to take more time with God. 5 minutes in the morning, 5 minutes in the afternoon, and 5 minutes in the evening. Read a little bit. Read for 5 minutes in the morning. Pray for 5 minutes in the afternoon. And then read for 2.5 minutes in the evening. Remind yourself and then pray for another 2.5 minutes. Something along those lines. And I don't know if you knew this, but I want to reiterate it. We have weekly reading guides out there at the Welcome Center that coincide with the sermon series that we're in. So would you stand with me? I know I had a lot of information to give you, but just like Joshua, God told Joshua, be strong and courageous. Obey all the law that I've given, I've given Moses. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left. And let Let the law of the Lord be on your lips and meditate on it day and night. That's what we do. Be strong in the Lord. You know the battle plan. We're going to pursue Jesus together. We're going to become like Jesus together, and we're going to make Christ known together. But right now, as we come to a response time, I want you to make the decision today. Well, this is kind of reiterating last week, to be strong and courageous in Christ. Make the decision to obey the teachings of Christ. Make the decision that I'm not going to turn from Christ. I'm going to get rid of the idols if there is any idols in my life. Make the decision, I will learn to meditate on the Word of God that points me to Christ. Make that decision in your heart and in your prayer right now. Lord, this is what I want. I want to be a part of what you are doing. So, Lord, as we put our hands out in front of us with all of our flaws and all of our weaknesses, with all of our shortcomings and all the things that we deal with, Lord, if there is anyone in this house right now that, like even just talking about idolatry and it hit them between the foreheads, that that's them. Lord, I pray a spirit of repentance and forgiveness upon their life right now, that they will turn from that, that they will throw the idol in the fire and let it be burnt up and fix their eyes upon you, Jesus. I pray even this day that they won't leave that to themselves, but that they'll do the dirty work of getting into a small group, even confessing, hey, I've been dealing with this problem. That's why I'm here. I want to follow Jesus. I want to be in prayer. Maybe even after service, just coming to the altar, coming saying, Lord, I want to give this to you. I don't want this in my life anymore. I don't want to be greedy anymore. I don't want to be filled with sexual immorality anymore. I don't want to live a life that leads to death, but I want to follow you who leads to life. Lord, let that fire burn within your people. Let there be a desperation in your people to say, Jesus, I want to obey you. I want to meditate on you. I want to grow in you. I want to know your words. And let that desperation and that fire turn into action. So, Lord, when we may feel overwhelmed and knowing not how to fight this spiritual war, may we remember we fight it in community. We fight it being strong and courageous in the Lord. And we fight it being obedient to Christ. May your favor rest upon your people. May you encourage them and strengthen them. May they hear your voice as they meditate upon you. And may they know that they are walking with you. And if we are not, let your Holy Spirit convict us, Lord, so that we may make things right. And in Jesus' mighty name, all of God's people said, amen. God bless you, church. I'm going to be down here. My prayer team's going to be down here. Love to pray with you and talk with you. And need to get something off your chest. Let's do it.
To my senses, couldn't make it on my